Welcome and thank you for joining the webinar today. I'm Amanda Jadro, the Director of Portfolio Management at Tricom. As an administrative and financial solutions provider to the staffing and consulting industry, it is our philosophy to be an active member of the staffing industry by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For that reason, Tricom was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series designed to share our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. One of our core values is to build relationships and become a leading resource to staffing and consulting firms nationwide. Our presenter today is Timothy Shuhai, partner in Curtin and Hefner firm, and serves as the chair of the staffing, recruiting, and workforce team. As part of this team, Tim counsels staffing industry clients with respect to growth strategies, succession planning, mergers and acquisitions, compensation strategies, plans and policies, risk management and indemnity issues, operational issues, goodwill protection, and competitive issues, and the structure and content of client and business critical contracts. Tim is a frequent contributor to legal and business publications and lectures across the country on emerging issues impacting the staffing industry. The attorney is in the staffing, recruiting, and workforce group at Curtin and Hefner LLP, provide legal advice and representation focused on the distinct concerns of the staffing industry clients throughout the United States and beyond. Their attorneys have experience in servicing the needs of staffing industry clients ranging from smaller, highly specialized firms to larger publicly traded staffing companies, serving numerous market sectors including light industrial, professional services, legal, accounting, and finance, IT, healthcare, engineering, and commercial. Remote work is here to stay. As the post-pandemic workplace evolves, the need for clear, non-discriminatory remote work policies is key for continuing success in the re-emerging economy. As recent events have shown, working remotely can be just as challenging for employees to navigate as it is for those on a supervisory level. Making an amendment to an employee handbook can make expectations clear for employees and lessen business interruptions and create some more efficiencies. Vaccination policies are also here to stay. These policies can either be mandatory or voluntary. Either approach can raise issues for employees. For example, some employees have strong feelings that their employers should mandate vaccines before returning employees to the workplace to protect everyone's health and safety. Alternatively, other employees may think that a mandatory policy or even requests to determine vaccination status are invasion of their privacy. So in today's webinar series, Tim is going to explore the importance and details of these critical new policies. If you have any questions during the presentation today, please utilize the chat feature. And with that, I'm going to turn the floor over to Tim.
Thank you so much, Amanda. Thank you, Tricom, for having me today as part of their Industry Insider webinar series. The introduction that Amanda very kindly gave is I'm deeply involved with the staffing industry. I represent over 100 brands nationally and internationally. So these issues are a pretty big deal and are something that is going to impact revenue, operations, and so on for the foreseeable future. Also, with most of these seminars, I'm going to be talking about the reality of what it looks like for you as an employer, for your own internal staff, for your W-2s and your independent contractors, but also like most issues in the staffing industry, I call it Russian nesting dolls, is you have this reality and then you have this reality with your clients as well. So as you're sending your employees in somebody else's workplace or remote workplace, their policies and the way they view the world also impacts the way you put people into that work environment and how it intersects with your own policies. And we'll discuss that. And it's something that I always say, communicate, communicate, communicate. So with that said, a couple ground rules. Please ask questions. I'd like this to be as interactive as possible. Secondly, I am not actually here. It just makes me feel better to think that I am. And I hope everybody else is enjoying a good day, maybe not as good as this, but with that said, I'm going to jump in, tell some more stories to go along with this from my experience with clients and so on. So we're going to talk about remote work first and then vaccination policy second. They do intersect quite a bit, and that's why it's nice to pair them. Okay. Yep. Working your sweatpants is here to stay. You know, right now we're all on camera, or I'm on camera, and it's nice to work from home. And I think a lot of people have really grown accustomed to it, including employers. And you can see that Gartner International, for some stats, say that remote workers will represent 32% of worldwide employees by the end of 2021. That's an enormous number that is substantial. But even more interesting to me is the attitude of workers right now. I mean, this data is reflected in the next bullet point that nearly 50% of U.S. workers say they would take a 5% pay cut to stay home and work from home. And 25% said they would quit their job if they couldn't work remotely. So that is a sea change, absolute sea change for employers, that the workforce is changing. And also this affects staffing companies' ability to fill recs, because if this is the attitude of workers, matching them up with people and clients that are willing to provide this type of work from home environment is something that is a huge challenge. And from my experience recently talking to owners at a conference in Dallas, it's creating issues, not just the number of people that have dropped out of the workforce, but the demands of workers entering the workforce and what they're looking for is vastly different than it was prior to the pandemic. All right, it's all about policies. Remote working, work from home is all about policies, policies, policies. They impact HR and employment law, data protection and security, productivity and social challenges, and implementation and maintenance. Well, I'll cover all these fairly quickly. I think many of my clients already have started to address this. I've helped a lot with handbooks on this, but let's jump right in. So, HR and legal issues. It really, they're not very different. They're just in a different setting. So it's the same wine in a different bottle. So what you have to look at, and probably the primary thing, is determining eligibility for teleworking or work from home. Certain jobs are not suited for work from home. Say, for example, a receptionist. Somebody has to be at the front desk to take in mail, greet visitors, and so on, enforce policies, social distancing policies, and such. So there are certain jobs that are not really eligible for remote work. You have to make the determination of eligibility pretty clear. That would be my recommendation. Why certain jobs are eligible, why certain jobs aren't. And they can't be based on any, you know, easy to say Title VII discriminatory aspect. So you can't say certain jobs are discriminatory because they make people, that they violate people's religious beliefs or other protected class issues. So making that determination of eligibility is very important. It's very important to make it clear why some jobs are eligible and why some jobs aren't. Timekeeping is essential, especially for non-exempt employees. It's the same as if they're in a workplace. The problem that we have, and what many of the clients are facing, is the workday is no longer 9 to 5. It's 9 till whenever people stop working, whether they're working during the day, keeping time. There's a lot of stories floating around out there about people doing more than one job. You know, primarily that they were furloughed from one, they took another job, and now they have two, and neither employer knows that they have both jobs, and they are able to do it surreptitiously, you know, on the down low while they're at home, because neither employer knows that they're doing both jobs. So that said, timekeeping, especially for non-exempt employees, still applies. They need to keep their time. You know, you don't want to be subject to you know, wage and hour claims for not paying time and a half or overtime. So timekeeping is essential. Meal and rest breaks are still in place, that you encourage people to take their lunch hour, to take their breaks. That has to be documented as well for the same reasons as timekeeping. Reimbursement of expenses related to work from home. Various states and municipalities have laws that require employers to pay some or all of expenses related to internet connection and other work from home expenses. That's very important. And if anybody has questions about that, the particular state or local government regulations, feel free to reach out to me and we can talk about it. Personal safety issues. Even though they're working from home, they're still working. And having very clear policies about safety in the workplace also apply to the work from home environment. God forbid someone gets hurt while they're working at home, your workers' comp insurance is still in play. That hasn't changed. You know, whether that changes going forward, hard to tell. The law, as I am off to say and I'll say frequently today, is a trailing indicator. It's not ahead of trends. It's always behind. So right now, personal safety issues are still an issue and should be handled accordingly. One of the biggest issues of liability that's facing work from home is data security. Lots of people are working in from home, not using secure servers, or using or working outside of their home in public spaces that don't have all the protections from, you know, spyware, malware, and being hacked. And it's something that a lot of companies are now having to put in. If they didn't have it before the pandemic, they have it now. You know, dual authorization to log on, and other security measures that have to be implemented because workforces are so dispersed now and are not in a central location, that it's vitally important to protect your remote environment. And a lot of people are doing through handbooks. We'll come back to that. Then there's measuring compliance. How many people, even though you require it, how many people are actually availing themselves to it as they're working remotely? And if they're not, what measures can you take to enforce it? And unlike other things, the pandemic hasn't changed this. If they're not complying with measures, you can take disciplinary action as you would with any kind of employee non-compliance issue. So it could be from the reprimand to probation to firing, depending on the level of the offense. Also, additional support may be necessary for remote workers. There is data that shows that IT support, especially for companies that do it remotely, is going up through the roof because of the number of requests by remote workers to fix problems with network connectivity and applying some of the protection measures as well. The other issue that's big right now is cyber insurance. And that's a whole nother lecture and a whole nother topic. But in short, you can get cyber insurance for first party and third party claims. So you can get insurance if somebody hacks into your network and creates problems. You can also get first party in case you or your own employees created the problem that allowed for a network breach. And especially if you have a remote employee working and handling sensitive data, say in the healthcare industry or the financial industry, that, you know, there's some grave consequences to the releases or unintended releases of data. So cyber insurance, it's out there. It's important. I recommend everybody, it's worth looking into, especially for your risk managers, determine whether it's a cost-effective measure for allocating risk or guarding against the downside of risk with all the people working remotely. And again, it's something to talk to your clients about what their policies are too, and whether your employees are working through their network. Productivity, social issues, the rise and fall of the virtual happy hour. Boy, that was all the rage for a while, and now I think people are just fatigued. Zoom meetings or Microsoft Teams or WebEx. I think everybody's become very facile in using these things, but I think there's a bit of fatigue for people that are utilizing these mechanisms to communicate. Using it for social connectivity is waning. There's data that shows that it is. So it's making it even harder to engage remote workers and keeping them feeling socially connected. It's also the data, and anecdotally also from speaking to my clients, productivity is at least matching pre-COVID, if not exceeding COVID. And there's lots of theories as to why. You know, at first people were saying that it was because the pandemic, people were more inclined to work hard and to ensure job security. But as things are going forward, I think a lot of people are finding that the flexibility, the lack of time wasted on a commute, both, you know, coming and going to work, the time wasted, at the water cooler or the break room, that people are being as productive, if not more so, because they have more flexibility. There's the Harvard Business Review is doing a lot of research on this, and it'll be interesting to see the hard numbers, but anecdotally talking to staffing company owners, they're seeing that productivity is not waning. And as a matter of fact, it's come down slightly for some, but it's still above pre-COVID. That begs a question about performance matrix. My discussion with staffing company owners, they haven't changed performance metrics, that people are still expect you to perform, and they're meeting them and exceeding them in many instances, as I said. We discussed reimbursement of cell phone and internet costs. Some companies do it as a matter of relations, you know, good relations with employees. Again, check with your clients and whether they're doing that and whether you can avail your employees to that same benefit. And also, as I discussed before, there's state and local rules and statutes that may require you to reimburse some or all of those costs. And like I said, social interaction seems to be waning. Many people don't feel as important as it was before, but certainly not as frequently. Some people were suggesting that you do it daily or weekly. I think most people have moved away from that and are going more to what they would do normally within office meetings. So all that said, policies are important. It's important to put them in a handbook. I highly recommend utilizing a professional to help you with formulating these policies. It never hurts to review your handbook in light of all the changes that have occurred because of COVID and do a refresher on those and add. I've done a lot of add for COVID related issues in the handbook and vaccination related issues in the handbook. So COVID is not just remote work. That's a separate issue, but the COVID is, you know, social distancing, other safety measures, whether you know, cleaning, who can be in the office, who can't be in the office, reporting of illness or non-illness, and so on. That's all been around for a little while here during the pandemic, but formalizing them and putting them into policies is really important. And then communicating the policies. It sounds pretty straightforward, but it's been an issue. It used to be you could just have the handbook and say, here's the handbook, everybody. Sign off and get your initials, send it back, so on and so forth. Now with people working remotely, you know, communicating the issues either in formally sending the handbook by PDF or otherwise to all employees or making it available on an extranet or both is very important. Also with some of the local regulatory reporting requirements that you usually hang up in the break room, you know, do you hang them up in the break room, but do you also make them available, you know, on an extranet or through email communications or other mass communications that are digital. Most of the people I talk to are starting to move to that anyway, because they're already communicating with remote workers in that regard. And staffing companies are somewhat at an advantage to other, in my opinion, to other industry sectors, because your workforce is very rarely, a majority of your workforce isn't in your workplace, like we said there, elsewhere. So you know, communicating with them has always been something that's first and foremost in the staffing industry. Is you're slightly ahead of the game being able to do that. Speaking of unique issues, like I said, it's more complicated because you have to deal with whatever the policies are with your clients. And if you have lots of clients, you could have lots of different policies about whether people are working full-time remote, part-time remote, what that looks like. Also, when we get the vaccination issues, that impacts that as well. And in large part, I think you're gonna see a lot of people in interplay between remote work and vaccination status going forward. You have to work with your clients to integrate data security protections. As I said, it's something that you don't want a claim coming back to you that one of the people you placed at a client caused a data breach, or that you breached the agreement with your client because they didn't follow protocol. You know, like most things, you need to go through these things with your client. And I highly recommend reviewing your client customer agreements. I know a lot of them come from your clients and there's a lot of pushback and change, but there's certain issues that are very, very important to everybody that weren't negotiated. I can guarantee you, I see contract after contract right now coming in that really didn't address the issues that are unique to the pandemic. So COVID wasn't anticipated, whether it's an issue about ability to perform, supply people, and that's a force majeure issue, or whether it's a, can you get people that are willing to be vaccinated because the employer that you're sending them to is mandating it. it's very important to review who's responsible, these contracts to review who's responsible for all these issues and to allocate them properly. And I can't stress it enough. I know I'm a lawyer and it helps pay the bills, but reviewing your customer contracts and agreements, and especially when something as big as this comes along, it may be time to renegotiate certain things, especially if there's additional costs. You may want to review your markup or your margin and account for costs that weren't calculated into that number that you've given your client. So yeah, I think it's very important to look at it for twofold risk allocation and for the economics of the deal to make sure that they haven't materially changed in light of the effects of the pandemic. So that's remote work in a nutshell. I think a lot of people are comfortable or getting comfortable with it. It's been around. I think everybody on this call, even if they're an owner, have worked remotely or work remotely in some regard or have people that have. So these issues, again, I strongly recommend that you review your handbook, add this into it, and do all the other measures to talk to your clients to make sure that it's working in a way that you can meaningfully make money and not be underwater in addressing these issues. With that said, the newer issue and the one that is really kind of dominating the headlines these days is the booster, the vaccination and boosters, and the collision between modern medicine and personal beliefs. And I left off here, and this will be an apolitical discussion, but it's become politicized in a lot of ways, if I might be so bold to say that it's become a political football. And whether which side you believe or what your personal beliefs are aside, I'm going to talk about the impact it has on the policies that are going forward. Not so much the political ramifications, but certainly it's affecting the workplace, good, bad, or other, it is. So I start with what a vaccine is. I think that's something that's pretty clear to people, or it seems it should be. There's a little confusion about it in some quarters of this country, but there we go. A vaccine is what we all think it is. Now we have, like I said, I was going to try to avoid the political aspect, but we can't. The Biden administration and its November 4th vaccination mandate. So ready, set, stop. So the mandate was twofold. It's part of a larger legislative and executive infrastructure and trying to get the workplace to be safe with vaccines and mask requirements. So the Biden administration on November 4th came out with a vaccine, one through OSHA, one through CMS. Most that apply to private, for the most part, where most of it is causing an issue, is it's mandating private employers. So if you are dealing with the government and you like under the CMS, and that's related to the healthcare industry. So if you're taking Medicare and Medicaid payments and or you're a governmental contractor, you're going to be subject to, you know, the CMS. So the Biden administration said, look, we're coming out with this mandate. It will cover approximately 84 million employees across the country. Under the OSHA, and I'll go into why the ETS is important and I'll explain that. But all that said, the ETS OSHA mandate was stayed. There was several lawsuits brought and it was stayed by the Fifth Circuit, claiming that the mandate was staggeringly overbroad and wasn't it was one size fits all and so on. So they stayed it pending. Now that doesn't mean that they've struck it down. They've just stayed it until there's further litigation to delve into whether it's an appropriate mandate or not. Since that time, that was last Friday when it was stayed by the Fifth Circuit, there's been so many lawsuits, more than two dozen, challenging the policy that the Biden administration used the court system to consolidate all of those matters into one. And that will be before the U.S. Court of Appeals in the Sixth Circuit. So the Fifth Circuit has stated, now everything is under the ETS has been swept up to be looked at by the Sixth Circuit. And that happened on Tuesday. So it's Thursday. We'll see what the Sixth Circuit does to stay issue additional stays or what they put out as a briefing schedule, how expedited it's going to be or not. So that's early days. It's only been two, obviously, since that's come down. So the ETS is stayed for now, and I'll come back to that. The CMS has not been stayed. More than 12 states have sued. It's to be determined whether any of those courts are going to stay, whether the Sixth Circuit's going to stay it. But right now, it's unstayed. Could be stayed as soon as tomorrow, as far as we know. But if you are subject to the CMS, it does cover healthcare workers. It mandates that all healthcare workers be vaccinated by the 18th of January of next year, or have an approved exemption from the vaccination requirement by January 4th of next year. So right now, it's in play, and it's a fairly short timeline. But why I'm going to focus on the ETS is because I think it's very, very important that it may come back in some form, but it also provides a blueprint for private vaccination mandates. So if you follow the rules in here in your own private context, it gives you some comfort that you're doing what you should do, or gives you some benchmarks that you can work from. So we're going to delve into the Emergency Temporary Standard from OSHA, or ETS. It applies to employers with 100 or more employees. And that means 100 or more at any time during the pendency of the ETS. So if you start out with 90 today and the ETS runs for 6 months and you exceed 100 during that 6 month period, ETS applies to you. So it's for employers with 100 or more employees that are fully vaccinated or test at least once a week. So we'll get into what each of those mean and why. Like I said, it will remain in effect for 6 months or until May 5th, 2022. Now this is a regulatory guidance or regulation. So the fact that it's been stayed means these dates will very likely, if it becomes unstayed, will be changed. It's not gonna be like, oh, the court's gonna wait until April 30th and rule, and then it runs out in 5 days. I would imagine that OSHA and the Biden administration would reset those dates for when the ETS actually becomes effective. Also, it's a self-sustaining regulation. So if no permanent standard is in effect by the 5th of May under the current regulation, it would just expire. But importantly, the ETS does not apply to employees that do not report to a workplace where co-workers or customers are present. I'll come back to that. Employees working from home, see above, which we discussed, or employees working exclusively outdoors. So for a long time, it took me a while to figure out what employees that do not report to a workplace where co-workers or customers are present. And the best I can come up with is that's truck drivers. Those are commercial truck drivers driving by themselves. They're not with co-workers. They're not going to a place of work. So the ETS would not apply to truck drivers. As for employees working exclusively outdoors, there's no definition right now as to what exclusively outdoors means. For a lot of workers say that they're in the construction industry, you know, a lot of times there's a meeting indoors or break rooms that are indoors. So does that rule them out as being exclusively outdoors? If people that are working out in the agricultural sector, if they're in fields, do they come indoors for breaks? And this is, again, an exercise, a lawyer exercise in trying to figure out what working exclusively outdoor means, especially when it conflicts with certain OSHA and other Department of Labor requirements for providing people that work exclusively outdoors with indoor break spots and so on in case of inclement weather otherwise. So this hasn't been worked out, and probably would be subject to litigation at one point or another to figure that out. The other thing I will say before I move on is it talks about employees. The ETS is for W-2 employees. It does not apply to 1099 independent contractors. So when you're doing your 100 employee count, independent contractors and 1099s do not count in that 100. So the ETS does not apply to independent contractors subject to 1099s. So we say fully vaccinated. So that means you have to prove that you're fully vaccinated. So under the ETS, of acceptable proof is a vaccination card. My personal experience having been fully vaccinated and receiving the booster is I have an electronic one. And I also carry a picture of my card. As an aside, I was at a public event in downtown Chicago, a performance, and to get in, you had to present your vaccination card. They didn't tell anybody that, but thankfully, you know, having it on my phone, I was able to show it, and it was readily accepted. Now, there's a lot of issue and discussion about what a vaccination card looks like. I mean, it's a simple card that they put a sticker on. They are very easy to create counterfeits of. They're very easy to mimic, and there's not a whole system of checks and balances to determine whether they're valid or not from the issuing entity and from the accepting entity. So as an employer, someone may present you with a vaccination card, and honestly, if you have one, you look and go, oh, it looks like mine, but it's really, you know, there's no clearinghouse or any way to actually authenticate it. So I think that that's, you know, the regulation says a vaccination card, but it's hard. It'd be hard pressed for an employer, and I have some employers that talked about this with me, about how do you prove that it's an actual vaccination card that's legit, it's theirs, that it actually came from somewhere. And so right now there's no way to confirm that. So it's a vaccination card, a record from a pharmacy or a healthcare provider. So, you know, that's what that shows is, you know, date of vaccination, who received it, and what was the vaccine. Or, and here's another one, any other official document that includes the date and type of vaccination, place employee receives vaccine. That's a catch-all. Not sure what that means, again, to be litigated if it comes to it. Now, under the regulation, if you're unable to produce this type of record, the employee can do a self-attestation, meaning they can say, I promise, I swear that I did it. Here's when I got my vaccination, fool, all right? And as much information I can get, and I'm gonna sign in and say, I am doing this because I can't find my vaccination card or I can't produce it, whatever that means, but I swear that I have been vaccinated on the following days. That is receiving a lot of criticism because, again, as an employer, does that mean you have to present your employees with some kind of form if they don't have a card? You know, how do you implement this? You know, is this another part of your onboarding? Is it a follow-up? I would imagine it would be, but what do you do with existing clients or existing employees? And what are your clients doing about this? I am telling my clients to talk to their end customers about how they want the employees that you're assigning to them to conform and then work from there. But it doesn't excuse you from having one for your own internal employees, whether they're ones that you temporarily send out in place or whether they're your own staff. You know, you have to have some kind of measure. You must provide up to 4 hours of paid time off to receive a dose of vaccine. So right now in the Department of Labor standards, you're gonna have to give people some time off. You're gonna have to give them reasonable time and paid sick leave to recover from the side effects. As many people know that, you know, the reactions to the vaccines, depending on whether it's Pfizer, McDermott, or Johnson & Johnson, is individual and can be quite substantial depending on the person, and can be different from first, second, or third inoculation. So you have to give them reasonable time, but you can require them to use their existing sick leave to recover from the side effects. So you have to give them time, but they have to use their sick leave. So at least in this regulation, you're not incurring another cost or lost time with respect to people having to recover from the side effects. Okay, so testing. So if they aren't vaccinated, they can't prove it. So there's unvaccinated employees and they're divided into two groups. Employees who report to workplace at least once every 7 days must be tested at least once every 7 days. So 7 and 7, I call that. Or people that work remotely and occasionally report, because what I didn't discuss, and it's an emerging issue and the data is all over the place, is there some people that are fully remote and then there's a whole series of hybrid models right now. Lots and lots of very prominent companies have gone to a hybrid model where, you know, you can work remote, but you only have to report to the office 3 times a month or 4 times a month. Under this vaccination or testing requirement, that's an occasional reporting and they have to test within 7 days of reporting. So say the requirement is you have to come to the office 4 times a month, Well, if they do it once a week, then they're going to be like everyone else and have to do it every 7 days. Or if they do 4 days at the end of the month, they have 7 days to do it. Again, who tracks that? Do? How do you do that with respect to employees you've placed elsewhere? It means you have to really work in conjunction with your clients to determine who's been reporting and who hasn't, because you as the employer record are still, you're the one that's subject to these requirements, not your client. The tests have to be documented, and they have to give it to you as the employer. If they do not test or test positive, they're not permitted in the workplace. Again, that's your workplace or your client's workplace. You do not have to pay for the cost of the test. You can require the employee to pay for it, subject to whether there are other state laws or collective bargaining. So you have a union. Issues, there may be requirements in your collective bargaining agreement that require you to pay those testing costs. Also, it may be unclear, and back to the point about reviewing your client contracts, it's vitally important that you review them to see who would have this cost. So upfront, most of the time, staffing companies incur the cost of doing background checks. This testing requirement is not a one-time thing. It's not a one-and-done. It's an ongoing thing. So that's a cost that should be passed along probably to your client, and whether that is calculated in your markup or not, I can almost guarantee it's not. It may be something that to open a discussion with your clients on your agreement, amending your agreements to account for these things. You can voluntarily pay for the testing, and you can require more frequent testing than under the regulation. The regulations looked at a minimum requirement, and you must keep the records of each result, and you must keep them confidential. Whether, you know, there's HIPAA information there and that law starts to cover the what you have to do with that information. I think ahead of everything, you need to keep it confidential, and for all the practical reasons and for the legal reasons. There'll be much more guidance on this as we go forward, but I think a very conservative approach is the best approach in that regard. So there's testing. So what kind of tests are there? And some of this, again, is regulations that haven't had comment, haven't been parsed out as a final regulation. But right now they say an at-home or over-the-counter tests are permitted, both those types of tests, but they cannot be self-administered and self-read. So that means you can buy an over-the-counter or home test, but it has to be sent out to a pharmacist or a doctor to read and report the results. So proctored over-the-counter tests, point of care tests, so you can do it at a Walgreens or a CVS or a Rite Aid. And then tests where the specimen is collected and processed is either done, whether it's done or observed by an employer. This one, there's not a lot of guidance on what that means. So say your clients are administering tests as part of, you know, requiring people to come in the workplace. The parameters of how that works. So, I mean, okay, they're going to collect specimens at the workplace and processing it, and it's observed by an employer, either through a third party that they've hired or that they've actually done themselves, are right now considered acceptable tests. What all those parameters mean hasn't been determined yet. You as an employer will be required to have employees report positive test results regardless of their vaccination status. So even if they're vaccinated and you require testing, now under the law, the regulation as it stands now, if there's a positive test, whether vaccinated or not, you got to report it. You're not, as employers, required to provide paid time off to employees who's removed from the workplace due to a positive test. So all the help that was out there for employees supporting them, you know, whether they were furloughed or out of work or you know, temporarily unable to work, is, you know, that's still there, whether they can apply for unemployment and whether the government comes up with more funding. That's separate apart from, you do not have to pay for them. You're not required to pay for time off because they're removed for a positive test. So that's important. So you have vaccination and testing, or masks. So each employee who's not fully vaccinated must wear a mask or face covering, as they call it, while indoors or in a vehicle with a coworker. Okay, here's the exceptions to wearing a face covering. Employees alone in a room with a floor sitting walls with a closed door, meaning in their office by themselves. For a limited time while eating or drinking, I think lots of us have experienced that with respect to going to restaurants. I've been in various states in the last couple weeks where in certain states, it's like COVID never happened. There's no signs, there's nothing that says, you know, people wear masks, they're doing it because they want to. There's no sign at the door saying you have to wear one. And certain states do have those signs, but don't enforce it. And other states are very, very strict about enforcing those. So, you know, but all of them allow you to take the mask down while you're eating or drinking for a limited time. My experience is everyone just takes their masks off while they're sitting at a table. When an employee's wearing a respirator, that kind of makes sense. Or if you can show that wearing a face mask is not feasible or create a greater hazard. Now, that's a catch-all. I'm not sure what the standard is for feasibility, and it hasn't been determined what causes a greater hazard. Is greater hazard meaning that wearing a face mask is a greater hazard to your health than contracting COVID? There's no guidance on what those mean right now. And it really, to me, creates kind of the evil in the piece for an employer. Because I don't know how you show it's not feasible or that it would create a greater hazard. I think, you know, you would take a practical approach, but right now there's nothing to measure it against. Okay, employers, you must permit employees to wear a face mask or covering if they want to, whether it's required by the ETS or not. So you can't say no. Under this regulation, you can't say this is a mask-free environment, and if you wear a mask, I'm sending you home. As odd as that sounds, there are you know, employers that are taking that stance, right or wrong. But under the federal guidance, if someone wants to wear a mask, even though the employer's not requiring it, you have to allow them to do it. The ETS does not require employers to pay for your employees' face coverings. And again, unless it's covered by a separate law or collective bargaining agreement, which would require it. So this is a little complicated because during the pandemic and under a lot of the safety measures that employers put in place for the workplace, they included providing face coverings. And a lot of places do. We'll have a face covering available at a reception desk. If you don't have one, they'll ask you to use one of theirs. So that's another area where employers have been providing these, but now in the ETS, the cost doesn't necessarily have to be borne by the employer. And again, like most things, you got to check with your end customer on whether it's something, how they approach it, face coverings. Now, moving on, and this is important strategically. This is a lot of legal expertise here. This is like a law school exam question, comparative law question, administrative law question. But because politically, the federal government is completely juxtaposed to a lot of states and their stance on vaccination and testing and face coverings, that whose law applies. Now, in the ETS, OSHA states, and this is pretty common, that federal law preempts, meaning it is superior to or replaces state and local laws prohibiting vaccine testing mandates or face covering requirements. So like many federal laws, they do preempt state laws on the same subject to what I'm about to say below. So if it comes down to a conflict between federal law and federal law would preempt state law. Lots of legal challenges to that are forthcoming, I'm sure. And it's not an area of law that is unsophisticated. Federal preemption of state and local laws is an ongoing issue outside of this context, clearly. And there's a large body of law on this. So if the ETS passes muster and clears the court system and becomes the prevailing regulations, I think that it's pretty clear that, in my opinion, OSHA will preempt state laws. Interestingly, and this is kind of a counterintuitive way of saying it, you as an employer can comply with ETS if and when it becomes applicable, and state laws prohibiting vaccination mandates, by allowing testing for unvaccinated workers. So that way you can sidestep the vaccination mandates by just testing everybody. Because under the ETS, you can either require everybody vaccinated or you can test everybody. So if they're unvaccinated for whatever reason, you have to test them. Now, there are some states that are going so far as to say that, you know, they don't even want testing, but I think most people are pretty comfortable with the testing aspect. Also, OSHA, you know, explains, and this is a little bit of thumb on the scale for them, that, you know, the ETS regulations for everyone's best interests and health. So doing something less than that is, you know, not good for the general population, let alone for employees, and really puts people in harm's way by not following these simple regulatory scheme that OSHA is setting out. States that also have their own OSHA or Occupational Safety and Health acts, they can adopt the federal one as long, and it can be slightly different as long as it's as effective of as the federal ETS, whatever that means. We're not sure again what that means per se. So states can say, hi, we're going to adopt our own state version of this. It's not exactly the same, but it is as effective as the federal emergency, the ETS. So that hasn't happened yet, and we'll see. If OSHA gives state, if someone goes and does a state plan, they have 30 days to do so, and if they do it, they have to report within 15. All that may happen. Not yet, because it's been stayed, obviously, but it may happen. The takeaway from this is if the ETS survives, it's going to trump, pun intended, I guess, state and local laws and create probably a whole fervor about this. And we'll talk about the lawsuits that are pending and the different views of different states on whether they should do this or not. So with that said, you have all these mandates and undefined regulations floating around out there that don't apply yet, but might. At some time in the near future, it seems that the court system is going to look at these very, very quickly, or quicker than they usually do. Maybe not quick to everybody, you know, layman, but in legal sense, you know, a very expedited way of looking at them. So you have all this swirling around. What happens if you want to just have your own vaccination policy, or if your clients have their own vaccination policy, and they can be voluntary or mandatory? And like most policies, you have to clearly identify the scope of the policy and to which employees it applies. So you may want to mandate it for certain jobs and not others, depending on the level of interaction and so on and so forth. That's why we just went through the ETS. They give you some parameters, whether you want to use them or not, to determine what types of jobs. So truck drivers, people that are alone, not in contact with people, they don't have to get vaccinated under your policy, perhaps. Or if they're working from home. So the whole exceptions to the ETS would be very, very useful to use in your own policies. It should also mandate why these policies are important. It's for worker safety. And in large part, you may have people in your workforce that feel very strongly one way about vaccination and testing and face coverings. And other people that feel exactly the opposite and feel unsafe because other people are in the workplace that are unvaccinated or untested or aren't wearing face coverings. And it creates a whole issue. So you have to back up the rationale for why. You're protecting not just the individual who wants to be in the workplace, but all the coworkers or the people that they're exposed to. And so pulling that rationale is pretty easy. A lot of the governmental regulations have whole paragraphs and stats that are readily available of why it makes sense to do this for your employees' health and safety. Again, your policy should talk about how you prove or demonstrate proof of their immunization. And again, you can go back to the ETS and say, well, there's the vaccine card and there's the other issues. I think it's pretty fair that to model a policy after that is getting you the minimum of what you would need. You should also ensure, as we discussed, that all the information and documentation is confidential and be in a separate employee file. Now, it's interesting why I said that. Just today, it came across the news wire that Florida is set to become the first state to fine businesses over vaccine mandates. So as counterintuitive that is, there are states, and Florida being one of them, that not only are not adopting vaccination policies, they're actually intervening with private businesses and saying, we're going to fine you if you do. Interestingly, from a legal point of view, it's the lawyer that goes into a judge and argues one side of an issue on behalf of a client one day, and the next day goes in and argues absolutely the opposite for a different client. And the judge will say, well, which one's right? And the lawyer will say, whatever you're deciding today, Your Honor. So when you look at it, for Florida to say, we're going to directly intervene and fine private companies for voluntarily creating their own vaccination policies, is exactly the same interference with a business that they're claiming that the ETS is, requiring private companies to have vaccination and or testing requirements. So it's kind of like, which is it? That the ETS isn't good because it interferes with business, but if a business wants to just do it on their own private business, we're going to fine you. I think that if Florida does do that, it'll get challenged, and a judge will say to Florida, the Attorney General of Florida, okay, counselor, which is it? You don't want the ETS because it's, you know, the government interfering with a private business, versus you want to interfere with a private business to prevent them from mandating a policy or creating a voluntary policy. So this is a highly volatile area of the law, and it's something that, you know, is going to be played out in the courts, and unfortunately probably more so in the media, and further polarizing, unfortunately, the views on something that really isn't political. The COVID-19 virus doesn't have a political affiliation. It's a virus, and it's a public health issue that needs to be addressed. Whatever way that anyone believes, it can't, ignoring it is probably not the best response, or it's not a response. And it's probably, in one point, may, in my opinion, subject businesses to liability for ignoring it. I think it'd be hard pressed to say, hi, I'm an employer and I had absolutely no policies addressing the pandemic and people got sick and died. God forbid you be sued as an employer by an employee's family that passed away from COVID. Even though you could say, I didn't have to do it, the law required me to do it, it'd be very hard pressed to stand in front of a jury and say, that's the way it happens. Too bad. You know, that does not fly. So if you do implement a policy, you are subject to certain exceptions to a policy that you mandate. So this is standard, and this comes pre-COVID. So a lot of these, you know, apply to people who don't get the, you know, the DMR vaccine or other vaccines that you were required to have. So there are two general exceptions to a mandatory policy for vaccination. One, on account of a qualifying medical condition, meaning to get the vaccine would make would endanger the employee or the person receiving it because of an underlying health condition or sincerely held religious belief. Before COVID, you know, those were fairly identifiable, you know, Hasidic Jewish communities, Jehovah's Witnesses, and other religious groups that don't believe in vaccination for various reasons. And if you're a member of that religious group, you know, courts have generally recognized that if you have a sincerely held religious belief, that will exempt you from the vaccination requirements. Proving those, there's case law on both of those. I would imagine going forward that that law will be poured over into the same use with respect to COVID, and that that would be something you would be subject to with a policy, with a pretty stable body of law to measure that against. You should also, in your policy, assure workers that they will not be subject to retaliation for exercising their right, whether it's a qualifying medical condition or religious belief. The policy should also communicate potential consequences for people who fail to receive vaccination and does not obtain an approved exemption. Like all work matters, that could be increased safety measures, unpaid leave, or termination. So it's a full gamut of HR responses for people who don't comply with the policy, just like any other policy that you have in your handbook. Also, written policies requiring employees to disclose their vaccination status without requiring vaccination. So it should be very clear if the employee has to self-attest to it or show that they have been vaccinated. So it's back to that issue again. It's like, okay, you have a written policy and requiring them to disclose one way or the other. Whether you tie it to a testing requirement, I think that makes sense that you do that because that's something that is set forth in the ETS and seems to be a reasonable response to the situation. So if you do a voluntary one, there's certain rules you have to follow and your HR people have to be ready to deal with people who say, I don't want to do it because I have a qualified medical condition or a sincerely held religious belief. I've had clients that have had this happen already. Interestingly, the response is, well, you didn't have this problem with respect to the measles vaccine that you had to get to be a home health worker, but now you don't want this. So it creates not only a legal issue, but a real issue with respect to your temps that you're placing places and whether they're going to want to be vaccinated, not want to be vaccinated or apply to any of this, and just creates a headache on you trying to feel rocks, trying to please people in the workplace, in a workplace. So where does that leave us? Your handbooks. I can't stress it enough that right now you need to document for your own risk allocation for the protecting your employees and protecting the employees at your clients' work sites as well. Because remember, under your client contracts, you send somebody in who's untested and has approved their vaccination status. Somebody employed by your client gets COVID and says, I got it from that guy that came from that staffing agency. And your client picks up your client contract and says, under the indemnification provisions, you have to reimburse me for everything that just happened with regard to that. Again, why you need to go back and look at your client contracts, because when you agreed to that indemnification provision and said, yes, I will pay for certain things that I do and certain things that you do, I'll make you whole for that. This wasn't considered. I can guarantee you these issues were not considered in that negotiation. So it may be time to reopen that discussion with your clients. So update your handbooks, like I said in the beginning, not just to address these issues, but just COVID in general. You should also talk about the safety related issues and policies that you have them in place. If you haven't made them formal in your handbook, you should, or decide whether you're going to continue and put them in it. And like I've said all along, I would use the ETS as a guidance for crafting these policies to make it compliant with at least a minimum approach to protecting your employees. So that is a whirlwind tour of remote work and vaccination status. If there are any questions, I'm more than happy to answer them.
If you have any questions, please go ahead and submit them in the chat feature. We'll also put Tim's contact information up on the screen if you'd like to connect with him separately on any of the items discussed today. He'd be happy to talk with you one-on-one regarding your specific scenarios.
Absolutely happy to. Anybody has any questions, wants to discuss them in at length, I'm more than happy to do so.
Wonderful. Well, as we're wrapping things up, we're getting, good feedback. It doesn't look like we have any questions. You covered things very, very well for us today. So I thank you so much for taking the time to join us on the webinar. And Tim, for sharing your knowledge on remote work and vaccinations and the new business realities. We will have a recording of this session on our website, so please feel free to check that out and watch for information on our next webinar session. With that, I hope you guys all have a great day.
Thanks everyone.